I have to go to him and ask for forgiveness. So he stands under a tree, keeps looking at Swami's room, back and tells his mother, he says, Amma, I have seen God. This person came to Swami in a very young age. He belongs to a typical rural village farmer family from Nellore. He belongs to a family that, you know, they don't do much. They have a small piece of land. They do a little bit of tilling on that land. They have some cattle. Whatever milk comes out of that, they sustain themselves. So he had a brother and a sister. So each one had given tasks. So he had to take the buffaloes and cows for grazing. His elder brother would have to work in the field with the father, and the daughter will help the mother. Actually, the sister was pretty young. So this boy had the job of taking the cattle, and he would come back in the evening and help his mother with the dishes and all of that. So for some reason, this boy at the age of 8, he did not feel like eating non-vegetarian food, though it was an acceptable thing in the family. Everybody in the family were non-vegetarians, but just his compassion towards animals did not permit him to be a non-vegetarian, so he chooses to become a vegetarian, imagine at the age of 8. So even as he would take all this cattle for grazing, he had this little lamb, which he was very fond of. So he would always carry it along and wherever he would go. So one day, a group of people come to him and says, will you give us this lamb? So he says, no, it's my favorite lamb and I can't give it to you. So they say, we'll give you 5 rupees. His boy says, 5 rupees? He gets a little tempted. He says, no, but I want to keep my lamb. Okay, we'll give you 10 rupees. 10 is too much. Temptation is too much to resist. So he gives the lamb and takes 10 rupees. A couple of days later, his friends come and mockingly tell him, what do you think? You don't eat non-vegetarian food. You're a very compassionate person and all that. What happened to your lamb? I said, I sold it. Somebody asked me. They liked the lamb more than I liked it. They were ready to offer so much money. I gave it to them. And then his friends laugh at him and say, you know what happened? That lamb has become biryani now. They've eaten it up. This little boy, that hurt him so much. He said, I was responsible for this little lamb to die. He felt so pained by it. He went back home and he cried the whole night. He refused to eat food. His mother came and asked him, what happened? He said, no, I killed this lamb. So he says, no problem, don't worry, don't bother yourself about it. He says, no. I've been responsible for this. I don't know what I should do to atone. What should I do? Imagine 8-year-old boy. And just then, one of the neighbors in that village had just returned from Prashanti Nilayam after having Swami's darshan. So in all her excitement, she has come to this house and she is describing to this boy's mother how Prashanti Nilayam is and how Swami is. And even as this little boy is hearing this description, he says, he is God, only he can forgive me. I have to go to him and ask for forgiveness. So he tells this aunt that, can you take me to this Baba? I have to, you know, I've done this big crime and he has to come and forgive me. So everybody tries to tell him that, no, don't worry, it's such a small thing, don't be bothered about it. He says, no, till I take Swami's forgiveness, I will not eat a morsel of food. So then they decide, okay, let's take this boy. So this neighbor takes this little boy to Parthi, and they're coming from Nellore, right? Not very far away, it's in Andhra Pradesh only. They take 3 days to come to Puttaparthi. This is like in the 1960s. 3 days they come, and when they come to Parthi, it's pouring rain. The Swami is not giving darshan because there's no place to sit. So they come and they stand under a tree. They don't know what to do. And he says, I will not eat food till I see Swami and I seek Swami's forgiveness. And even as he's standing, somebody tells him that mandir, that is where Swami stays. So he stands under a tree, keeps looking at Swami's room. He says, till Swami comes out, till I can ask him for forgiveness, I'm not going to move out of here. So after a few minutes, Swami comes out of his room. And you know, all in gestures and through eyes, this boy cries. Swami says, it's okay. And Swami says, go. Pointing to his stomach, Swami says, go and eat. This boy is thrilled. He says, he has accepted my apology. So he goes, and it's a very short trip because Swami is not giving darshan. They return that very day. And he goes back and tells his mother. He says, Amma, I have seen God. Nobody can be as beautiful as that. Sai Baba must be God because nobody can be so beautiful. He's so beautiful. And imagine, this is the value mothers can teach. The mother, simple, uneducated village lady, she says, so what? She says, so what if you have seen God? Then what am I supposed to do? You should do Namaswarana, she says. It is waste if you have seen God and if you don't worship Him. You should do Namaswarana. So the mother gives him a Japmala, and Swami, and mother says she'll do Namaswarana every day. So he starts, I think, some Shri Sairam, he does. And wherever he takes the cattle for grazing, he would sit under a tree and he will start doing his japa. So one day he comes up to his mother and tells her, Amma, something very strange is happening. See, generally when I would take my cattle for grazing, I had to always be behind them because otherwise they'll go into somebody's field. But ever since I've started doing this japam, all the cattle are so well behaved. I don't have to take care of them at all. They seem to be minding their own business. And the mother says, yes, that is natural. See, when you take God's name, God will take care of your work. And this little boy saying, just because I want to take his name, how can I let him to come and do my work? How can I trouble Swami like this? So he tells his mother, I am not going to do japam henceforth. And the mother says, hey, you're feeling lazy and you don't want to do, and that's why you're doing all this. He says, no, no, Amma, I don't want Swami to come and do my work. So he says, I will take the cattle for grazing, I will take care of them, I will come back, I will help you in the housework. And then I will sit and do japam and then go to sleep. So every day he would do this, 8:30 to 9:30, he would sit and do his japam after finishing all the work and go to sleep. A few days later, one more lady in the village comes after spending about 1 week in Prashanti Nilaya, 1 week to 10 days. So the moment this boy comes to know that somebody has come from Prashanti Nilaya, he runs to that lady and she says, Tell me about Swami, what does Swami do, how are things there? So this lady gives a description of entire, a complete day in Prashanti Nilaya, what time it starts, what all happens. And then she says, around 7:30 Swami switches off his light and he retires. This boy is like, 7:30 Swami sleeps. I don't know if Swami sleeps, but 7:30 he switches off the light, so I'm guessing that he must be going to sleep. So then this boy asks, if I call Swami's name, will he listen? The lady says, Tapakunda, definitely he listens. Why you should have that doubt? Then how can I disturb Swami when he has already gone to sleep? He says, how can I disturb Swami? 7:30 he goes to sleep, 8:30 I'm disturbing him. So he goes to his mother and says, no, I'm not going to do japa. Again the mother says, hey, you're feeling lazy and you're trying to escape. The boy says, no, no, Amma, this is the thing. I won't do because I don't want to disturb Swami. See that innocent love. Right? Swami says, I've come to be loved like this. They try convincing, nothing works. He says, no, I will not do. Finally, they call one more lady and she says, see, it is not like that. Swami is everywhere. I don't think they would have explained to that kid the concept of time zones and all that. Because when Swami is sleeping here, it is waking time in America. Somebody must be calling him there. But they tell him, see, it is not like that. When we say Swami listens, it is the omniscient Swami, the omnipresent Swami who listens. You don't have to worry, you can do japa whenever you want. But this boy is not convinced. He says, okay, because all of you are telling he does japa. Then it so happens that after a few months, they decide to take this boy to Prashanti Nilaya and stay for 1 week. Because this boy is so devoted to Swami. So they again take the three-day journey, they come to Prashanti Nilaya and they stay. So this boy is like following all the schedule from morning Nagar Sankirtan to Suprabhatam to everything. This boy is not used to, you know, that kind of weather probably. So after about 3-4 days he gets congestion, he starts coughing. So he is not able to go for Suprabhatam. So after a few days, Swami calls him for an interview. Swami picks him up from the crowd. Swami calls him inside the interview room. And Swami asks him, hey, 3 days I saw you in Suprabhatam, after that you are not seen? This boy, he is asking Swami, Swami, first of all, you never come for Suprabhat. I have never seen you coming for Suprabhat. He says, secondly, it is so dark, how will you know who has come, who has not come? And then Swami says, hey, Bichwada, wherever you are, whatever you do, Swami knows. I know everything. And this boy says, oh, is that so, Swami? And then he explains, no, Swami, I had cough and cold and congestion and all that. So I am not able to, I didn't want to disturb the others, so I didn't come. Swami says, oh, cough, why, what happened? You know, having phlegm and all that, Swami, like doctor is asking. And then what Swami does, Swami waves his hand and materializes some vibhuti and pulls his shirt. You know, those days, typical small boy wearing knickers and shirt. Swami pulls his shirt, pulls his banyan and applies the vibhuti on his chest. And Swami says, don't worry, it'll be fine. So he comes back and very excitedly he tells his mother whatever has happened inside the interview room. And imagine the mother is asking, you fool, why did you give that extra trouble to Swami? Why were you quiet till Swami had to lift your shirt and lift your banyan? And then this boy says, yes, why did I do that? Then he says, Swami, Amma, when you stand in front of him, you forget everything. He's so beautiful, you just look at him and you lose everything. You just forget yourself. The most beautiful part is, he says, you know, now he's a close to 70-year-old man, 70 or 60, I think he still serves in the canteen. He says, the most beautiful thing was ever since Swami applied that vibhuti on his chest, this namasmarana has become nityasmarana. He says, I don't have to do because it goes on constantly here. Imagine that little boy's confusion. Should I do in the morning? Should I do in the evening? When is it disturbing Swami? When is it not disturbing Swami? In one stroke of that vibhuti on his chest, Swami has ensured it goes on endlessly. He says it has been 50 years, it has not stopped. What a blessing. He says, I don't have to think, it goes on and on and on. And even now when I'm speaking to you, it is going on and on, he says. Then he tells, you know, the boy's innocence. One day he and his father were walking towards the field. And there is that village deity's shrine was there. So this boy observed that everybody who goes towards the temple would remove their footwear and bow down to that deity and, you know, typically how we all do, and wear the slippers and go. So this boy looks at his father and says, what are they doing? Why are they doing like that? So they say, nothing, they're just praying to God before they go in for their work. He says, no, no, why are they removing their slippers when they're doing that? Father says, see, when you're taking God's name, you should not be wearing slippers, it's disrespectful. Boy says, is that so? When you're taking Swami's name, you should not be wearing slippers? He says, yes, it's a sign of disrespect. Then the boy says, but for me, that name is going on all the time, how can I wear slippers? And so father says, keep quiet, come now. Boy says, no, no, you tell me, this is a big problem for me now. And then and there he removes his slippers and throws it away and he says, henceforth I will never wear slippers because his name is going on all the time. Until today he doesn't wear slippers.